Kraken's an ironic term to use when we're talking about sea monsters, isn't it?
Well,
a little bit. So, we open for Aqua the day, more or less, after the first trial, or first day of trials with Director Elfman and the Shadow Court. It seems as though the Shadow Court is deliberated upon day by day as to how many days are needed for the trial, as opposed to the lengthier process that most of you are used to with public court. As well, the defense and the prosecution prep and kind of train and get ready between days, it seems like, in secret or otherwise, they're not really accessible. However, there is a small snag in the trial that could throw it into jeopardy, as Rust is very adamant that a video spreading around on the web of vibes, the Uzique network, is relevant to this case. He knows the details, obviously, of what you guys are working on. He is a member of Aqua, and he gathers everyone into a small viewing room. He himself is behind a black curtain in this viewing room. So if you want to talk to him, you're just talking to a curtain. It's completely blacked out, where he has a monitor set up, very thin curved display. And he accordingly plays the clip, The Ascension of Rafe Rasputin, for your group. On the screen, you see it as it is in the channel. It is footage taken from his cell. Rafe was being monitored because it is a very high stakes case. You will notice, as the video plays for your group on repeat, beforehand, Rafe was pacing around in his cell, muttering to himself, mostly words of worry about his mother, if he's even going to get out of this ever, how he probably would have been better off if he died. Then the moment when his cell door slides open with nobody there, and there isn't even the sound of a system being engaged, so no beep. It simply unlocks, the door opens, he stares at the open entrance, and as he does, a figure appears, angelic in nature, but not in execution, as once the figure flashes before Rafe Rasputin's eyes, there is a time gap or lapse in the tape. The recording is disrupted, distorted, and once it comes back to clarity, or at least in a glitch state, Rafe Rasputin is hanging from his ceiling by a rope that, according to the report, which Russ will provide to you, seems to have been nailed in or pounded into the ceiling at an angle that Rafe Rasputin couldn't have possibly reached. The cell was too high. He didn't have anything to climb up there with, not even on his bed could he reach this. He would have had to have jumped at the very highest he could over and over to pound this thing. He is just a normal person, so there's no way that could have happened. The Stella Maris prison system is already running its own internal investigation as to how this could occur, why. Their tech experts believe that their system has not been compromised, but they do not know how this could have occurred. I will say, I'll say Blue and Claudia actually have a good deal of experience with the prison system. Blue, in terms of, this is where it's easier for you to pick up potential informants or just check in on people that are connected to any undercover investigation you've been running. And for Claudia, this is where maybe you could or have in the past visited merfolk who have been taken in, people in the community that you know. So there's likely some overlap there. So for blue, if you could just roll me a piercing gaze, I think.
Shit, I'm away from my keyboard for a second.
I could roll it for
I'll
you.
be right back. Okay.
Passive difficulty three, we'll say. Okay. For you, Blue, your attention to detail and your familiarity with those cells tells you that those systems are usually strong enough and locked into place that most outside interference is not going to mess with them. But that does not preclude, in your experience, corrupt guards and any other kind of internal interference. This is maybe likely one of those cases. And Claudia, could you give me a secret sniffer roll, passive difficulty, also three? Would you like to invoke on that, or do you want to let it ride?
I'll invoke, this is to find out. Yeah, I think I'll invoke a community outreach investigator for this one.
Okay, one second. All right. Both of your successes allow you, your group, to get two free plus two invokes, two free boosts, basically to any check involving the prison. And for you, Claudia, that comes from the fact that you are familiar that this prison is not extremely safe for anyone that goes against the power structure. It's likely that the person running the prison system, or just every single part of it, is meant to protect the rich and elite and the politically connected, more so than rehabilitating anyone. So there have been many, many cases of prisoners who have gone missing or have been killed, and it disproportionately happens to merfolk. But you also know that when prisoners are called up as informants or are connected to any wealthy corporation or interest in Guam, sometimes coming to a Stella Maris or just a Guam prison or jail is as good as going to the gallows. There are way too many flaws and leaks in the system to keep it from happening, and it doesn't even have to be a grand hit like this. It could just be a prisoner who's at the end of their rope and wants to maybe make a few extra bucks or scrape a few years off their sentencing with a plea deal involving any corporation. In any event, oftentimes when somebody is sent to a Guam prison, this sort of thing can occur. Reef Rasputin, no exception. The only thing that stands out about this particular case, unfortunately, because you've likely seen so many, is the manner in which he seems to have been killed. Now, Claudia, you are also familiar with the fact that the, and Blue likely is too, very much, the people who run the correctional facilities in Guam, 9 times out of 10, they lie. They cover it. They will lie to cover their ass and keep their job. So trying to let them run their own investigation into this matter is usually a non-starter. You can, if you want, take on the Rafe Rasputin case, either one of you, Blue or Claudia, as a minor case, because you're not going to get very far right now. Or you can choose to instead just focus on the case with Danny and what you can contribute there. The prison system can wait, possibly. It's up to you. But if you do choose to take it on as a minor case, it will be kind of present in your goings-ons after this Director Elfman trial. Minor cases can be solved within a session, actually. So you can choose to work it today or you can put it off. It's your call. For now, either one of you, if you have any interest in that, you can let me know now, or you can just, bring it up later. Is there any sort of, connection or tie that would interest? For example, you, Claudia, personally spoke to Rafe Rasputin's mother and likely assured her that her son would not die or wouldn't be in danger. And now this is all over the web, this video. Most people are attributing it to a CGI sort of prank thing, or there's conspiracy theories about what that was.
Yeah, I do feel like Claudia would probably take it on at least.
Okay. We will make a minor case for that. And we will fill out a few details about that later. Anyway, after the video ends, Rust will address the group from behind the curtain. He has a small microphone that he talks into because he's actually not that loud. So you can hear his kind of distorted voice recounting various facts. If there was any sort of technology used to jam the signal, it's hard to tell exactly what by the distortions and pixelation that occur, as well as the warping various RGB elements of the video feed. It could have been somewhere like a man in the middle attack between camera and receiver. It could have been edited after the fact, disrupted due to data corruption. I will likely need to run more forensics on the footage itself. The prison system uses a very outdated technological format. A bit embarrassing, and when I made suggestions as to how they could update that, I was told to shut the F up, which I thought was rude.
It would make sense that they wouldn't want too much sniffing around in there.
Possibly a little too much corruption that they want to keep hidden.
It's pretty well known at this point. All the more reason for why we have to be so discerning and try to clean up our own house. Frustrating to work under these conditions.
There is another thing that I felt it necessary to gather information before I made a report on, but the blackmail materials that were stored on the softcell servers are, I thought them to be originals. They are not. These are just very near, in fact, incredibly close copies. I have never really seen a method used like this before. The loss of data, the any signatures involved in determining whether or not something is a copy or even a copy of a copy. Typically in forensics, it's simple. This is an extremely complex method. I'm at a loss. The only telltale bit of information that told me that these were copies was a small shift in one of the values.
It's surprising you were able to pick even that up. We're definitely dealing with some, how to put this? Forces that are incomprehensible. Doesn't just stop at technology. And connections that we aren't quite clear on.
How much study have you made to this copy?
I'm sorry, what'd you say?
How much study have you made to this copy?
Spent quite a long time pondering and shifting around values to see if I could replicate the method at least, or attempt to figure out what they did to make the copy. But to give you an example of how complex it must have been, the data would have had to have been reconfigured piece by piece by the smallest possible container of data. The replica, this would be like recreating a priceless statue, bit by bit with marble. The original's made of marble. The replication is also marble, and the contours and carving and all of the different flaws that make the original what it was are being replicated in this copy. In data, this would require something fast, I think. Something incredibly quick that might even violate the laws of thermodynamics in some way, which is concerning to say the least. We are, after all, the police, and we're meant to enforce the laws. Sorry, bit of levity. But it is intriguing. A system that runs at this speed, with this level of output. Yeah, well, it's intriguing. I have spent a lot of, maybe too much time.
Yes, fascinating. It's very dire.
This, not that it's a good look to point any fingers, but it's gotta be Dorbo.
I mean, can Dorbo can? Well, I guess asking if Sunny can control angels might be possible.
Angels? Do you?
I mean, that's what that is, right? I mean, it's certainly somebody pretending to be one.
Well, concerning the blackmail evidence. There's no way that Director Elfman could have done this himself. And we all saw Sonny just excuse himself essentially from the trial. Sonny still has skin in the game, so...
How does it benefit him to erase this particular voice?
It's probably nothing to him, right?
Yes, but I believe he wishes to keep Elfman in the jail, so erasing someone who would do that is... I'm not sure the motivation fits, but I do not understand all of his motivations yet. Yeah, there's a dog in the background trying to chase a ball. Yes, sorry.
I was going to say, I thought I heard the familiar pop of a dog biting too hard on a rubber ball.
Yes.
Well, we all saw it. Yellow would also be able to pull something like this off. They have stand users, and they were highly technologically advanced. Brotherhood of Alchemy, maybe? Yellow's obviously not around anymore. Unless someone from heaven is influencing. But there's no way. Right?
I mean, aren't they, if they're gods now, aren't they always kind of influencing things? I guess this is more of a direct approach, so I guess the real reason would be, why do the gods care what we do with a crown unless they're that worried about Avicii? But then why wouldn't they just take care of Avicii?
Maybe it's because maybe they can't, like, I mean, I know he's brain dead and everything, right? But like, what if even brain dead, he's still a big threat?
Of course he is.
Like even a threat to them.
It does make me wonder if any of the egregory would be interested in anything going on with this trial, really.
I have a feeling that our prosecution may be of interest to them, sent by them.
Yeah, you might be onto something there. We should probably approach her about that, right?
If her veil is dropped, will we have to switch prosecution? I would prefer not.
We're all on the same side. I think it's a harmless enough question. But, yeah, not the point.
She may have some knowledge of who the angel worked for.
All right. So, yeah, you guys kind of like have an idea of the mystery surrounding the trial right now. It is set to resume shortly. And I would say, by the pace of how the last day of trial went, this one probably won't end for a while. I mean, won't stretch on forever, but the complication of one of the witnesses just being pretty much assassinated is likely to throw in a couple complications. So I'll say we have Blue, Enya. Yeah, we have all you guys. And I will say, anyone who doesn't get a partner for their investigation, you can team up with Rust. But let's look at three different angles that you can each go out on. One of them, you know what? I'll just type them out real quick. So I'll let you guys pick which one you want to do. I'm figuring, Claudia, since you're investigating the death of Rafe Rasputin, you'd probably want to go to that one.
Yeah, I figure that would probably be the smartest to go. I mean, while she's there investigating Rasputin, she can always investigate the prison.
Sure, definitely.
And maybe Rust will help. I mean,
Yeah, sure. Rust can be involved if you want. Enya, which one of those three do you think you'd be interested in pursuing?
I'll wait to see what other people want. But if I had to pick right now, I guess to you.
All right. Mikey, this is your major case. So each one of these is kind of relevant to, or the monumental case rather, each one of these is relevant to that. Which one do you feel like as lead investigator you'd want to look into?
Going over the three options, I think Mikey would want to talk with Lucia first, just to kind of go over strategy with her, because obviously this suicide leaking out is going to be a big deal, and also there's a very good chance that Lee might use it against them in court somehow, or like try and use it as a tactic to like slip them up, so like they need to be ready for that and be prepared to stop that. Lucia first, and then I think if he had to bounce around to all three, he'd probably save Sunny for last. He'd want to investigate the prison to see what evidence he could drum up first. And then if there's anything there, kind of use that to, not necessarily against Sunny, but use it to kind of build a case if there is one.
These investigations will likely be run in parallel. So as the, you know, lead investigator, we'll say in universe, this is, you would have to maybe take a little lead and assign people, but we're just like framing it in this way so that people go towards the scenario that they are trying to pursue, whatever it might be. So, yeah, if I would say pick the priority, and if it's number two, then number two is good. You can trust your Aqua unit members to, I think, do okay on the other two that you haven't chosen, or at least you want to be able to trust them.
He would trust the others to do the work as well. He'd probably want to meet with Lucia since he's the head investigator or the head detective on the case.
Okay, so Ice Peak, which one are you going to focus on?
They're all good, so I'll go wherever you assign me.
Do you mind investigating the prison then? I feel like if Mikey can't do it himself, then he would likely send Ice Peak with someone.
Okay.
Because I feel like they both have that kind of analytical looking at the evidence. And yeah, and then Claudia being another scout.
Right? Oh, but Russ is going to go talk to Sunny. What is that going to happen? Oh, no.
Oh god, can you switch me out? I'll talk to Sunny.
With
Rust, I guess.
Blue, what do you think Blue would want to focus on? So your options are questioning Sunny, questioning your prosecutor, Lucia G. Wild, or investigating the prison.
First I was gonna say the prison, but if there's already...
You can swap me with her. It's fine.
Okay.
She does know more about police corruption and stuff, so she'd probably understand. Yeah.
Counter is going to be working on his own investigation. The investigation of what happened to your police chief.
Oh, God.
Oh, no.
That guy is still missing, and the interim chief is still not seeing anyone or allowing anyone into his office.
And Towner does know that Mikey did feel him out eating something that was likely people meat.
Right. So Towner's going to run his own investigation.
They'll get a snack.
They'll get mammoth burgers together.
Let's run down the so let's go basically in order to we'll go actually bottom to top. So investigating the prison will come a little bit first, handled hopefully rather quickly. Now that you've all broken into teams and are going to investigate different parts relevant to the case, Claudia and Blue have chosen to focus on the prison. Traveling to the Guam prison where Rafe Rasputin was being held, or jail rather, as he was in the midst of maybe likely being called again to the witness stand. The two of you, who I'm assuming share the same car, at least, to drive up. First of all, once you arrive at the jail in question, you are naturally treated with suspicion, but that's really nothing new for either one of you. Although I will say, Claudia, maybe there's like a guard or two who are friendly with you because they think that it's going to keep you from sniffing around too much, and that, but they're mostly patronizing. The guards of this particular jail are likely to be cut from the same cloth as some of your more corrupt Stella Maris PD police officers, and some of them may even be retired either with or without their consent. So they are veterans of the, some of them are veterans of the police force. It's maybe even likely that the two of you have met them on your way up through the police force as they were on their way out. So in a lot of ways, working in jails like this is like the retirement home for cops. For the both of you, investigating the prison is, I'll say, familiar ground. So, just, I guess it's a question of, do you take a more subtle approach to your investigation, or do you take a more forceful and maybe even hostile approach if you meet opposition or resistance? Which one do you try to do this in a smooth operator kind of way, or do you do this in a kind of threat of hellfire kind of way?
I feel like smooth operator would probably be the smart approach personally, for the start of this anyways.
Yeah, that's, I think how Blue would approach it.
Okay, and each of these pairings also, as to keep to tropes, one of you will be the good cop and one of you will be the bad cop. So which one of you is the good cop and which one of you is the bad cop? It just is a matter of when you need to exercise force, who's going to do it.
I feel like probably Claudia would be the good cop.
Yeah, that's kind of seems obvious. Claudia's the good cop and Blue's the bad cop.
There we go. We have our good cop and our bad cop. As the two of you are entering the prison, you will notice that there are certain guards that are gathered ready to change shifts. Some of them are on their way out, some of them are on their way in. Everyone is basically trying to pass off any attempt at questioning as they just want to get home and they don't have a lot of time to answer anything. It's been a very busy night. A prisoner dying in their cell, nothing new. The way in which it happened and the fact that the footage of it was leaked has probably a lot of people concerned that they're going to lose their job very, very shortly here. Which one of you would like to try and press some of the, we'll say, outgoing guards as they're changing the shift? Would you like to take the good cop or the bad cop approach to open with them?
Perhaps we should take a bad cop approach to these outgoing ones. I don't feel like they'll be receptive to just a normal conversation.
All right, the bad cop approach. In this approach, Blue, you know that some of these guards who are working here, and you even recognize some of them on the outgoing shift, were basically either in the midst of, or even some of them, connected to crimes of corruption, mostly pocketing what they seized during raids and drug busts. So you're seeing a lot of thieves, basically, a lot of people that maybe have deep pockets and deeper debt. we'll even have a few kind of like out of the crowd that you personally either had to investigate or had to investigate a connection they had to a witness of yours, or an informant. So these are people that you know can be bent, and you know that they likely already have been. What sort of, I guess, shakedown method would you like to use on some of the outgoing older police? You can choose to exploit through money, through prior convictions, through even reputation and pride. Which of those do you think Blue would try to seek information through?
I was kind of thinking maybe the reputation and pride type of thing. Like, she could make a comment. I don't know. Kind of bringing up something she knows about them.
Okay. We'll say one cop in particular, a woman by the name of Susanna Hale, was involved in a particularly bad drug bust that ended up with a cop shot and the main target of the investigation dead, with quite a bit of money that had gone missing. Susanna Hale was suspected of basically killing her partner and this target, the victim of the crime, the person being investigated for drug distribution, and then pocketed some of the money. Of course, if she was working in a prison like this, either it's for cover or for fun, who knows? It could be that the money she pocketed went right to whoever she owed money to. Either way, she couldn't hold on to her job after that. It was never proven that she pulled the trigger on anyone, but she definitely, it feels through any report that you saw, it feels like she either did it herself or has to know who actually did it. We'll say you catch her as she's about to leave, has her normal civilian clothes on. So, you know, coming out of the locker room more or less, talking to a few of the other guards before she takes off. She's a woman who, you know, from the records, lives alone for the most part, goes to visit her sister every now and again, and doesn't seem to have much of a life outside of work. So you want to press her on, what is it that you want to press her on? What method did you choose?
Kind of.
Her reputation, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So she recognizes you, obviously, and kind of averts her gaze as she'll give you like a nod and then try to just walk by you. How do you open up with her reputation?
You said her name is Susanna?
Susanna Hale.
Okay. I guess I'd start walking up next to her. Just matching her stride. And say, "Oh, hey, Susanna, how's it going?"
Have you ever tried to press her for information before? Or have you ever personally had a conflict with her?
I guess we could say that maybe I was involved, or
okay, kind
of fringes of her, whatever was going on with her.
Yeah, when you try to like get up and talk to her, immediately she looks uncomfortable, and she says, "Detective, what is it that you need from me exactly?"
I'm just wondering why it is you're working here. I thought you were doing great, you know.
Small businesses and businesses fail. What else do you need to know?
What happened to your business? I'm so sorry to hear about that.
It's none of yours to start. I know why you're here, Detective. It's to investigate the thing with Rasputin. Are you eyeing me? Do you think that I am involved in that? Because do I need my lawyer? I guess would be my next question. You can choose to press her if you want, or you can just kind of like ease off. But she is clearly, you can tell, Blue, you have the sense of a predator. This woman feels like prey right now. Like, she feels like she is scared.
I mean, I know what you're like. Why wouldn't I want to question you about what's happening here?
Go ahead and give me a shakedown roll. Pass the difficulty 2. Would you like to invoke, or do you want to let it ride?
Yes, I'll invoke. My need to maintain control of the situation.
Okay. Susanna stops and just kind of lets go of a sigh, but you can tell her she's a little shaky. She says, look, I've been up 16 hours, no sleep. This guy dying in his cell happens all the time, but I've never seen anything like that. You're asking about my business? Yeah, I tried to do a little catering thing. It sunk. I don't know, like, security maybe is where I should be, but, you know, I'm just doing this as a, like, day gig. I'm not even trying to get involved in whatever the hell happened in that cell.
Well, could you at least describe to me what you saw?
Same thing as everyone else. I mean, I was on the whole other side of the jail when it happened, and you can check my time cards and the cameras for that one. So I wasn't involved, and even if I wanted to be, she, like, looks around a little and scratches her forehead. They wouldn't give me access to any of the cell controls, so the computer records, look, I know how it looks, and I know what my reputation is, but I wasn't involved in any of that. I just want to go home and probably look at the Help Wanted ads or something. If this is how it's going to be now, she seems a little bit bewildered by the entire experience. Go ahead and give me a piercing gaze roll. So, a 0. Do you want to invoke to reroll, or do you want to just like let it roll? Let it ride?
I'd like to reroll.
Okay. What do you invoke?
I'll do my squad roll investigation.
Okay. Go ahead and reroll Prison Gazing. Good lord. A success with style. You can tell that she may be telling the truth about that she is not involved, but she likely knows something that she's not talking about. You can now choose to press her with physical or mental intimidation. You have advantage or a +2 with either. No, you actually have a +3 with either one, and you have your free +2 invoke through prison knowledge. So it's likely you're going to take the target out with this roll. But which would you like to exercise, mental or physical intimidation?
Probably mental.
Okay, go ahead and give me a shakedown roll. No, actually, you mean impale roll, but that's okay. We could just add a 1 to it. So a 1. Oh, I'm going to use the first result, but it hardly matters.
Okay.
It doesn't matter what you need to burn for it. So with a 1 and then a 3, that led you at a 4, you will more or less be able to extract more information from her. But if you use your prison knowledge invoke, use burning one of those, you will definitely take her out. Okay. It's up to you which one you want to invoke here.
Can I use just one of those and then save the other?
Yeah.
Point. Yeah, I'll do that.
Okay, then that puts you at a 6. So you're using mental intimidation. Socially take her out, not, yeah. So what's like a coup de grace do you think that you could land on her now that you know she's hiding something? You know that she's scared, and you know that she just doesn't want to be involved. And you're also using her reputation, I guess, as your angle. Which do you think that you would want to, what sort of approach? You don't have to go into like great detail. I can try to fill in the blanks if you don't really know for sure.
I guess I could threaten to out her to, maybe I know someone or some a connection that she wouldn't want people, you know, to know about her.
Okay, yeah, you know, like the contacts, the kind of circle she ran in. You may even know that she had a drug problem at one point. That she had to go to counseling for. That's not exactly supposed to be any knowledge that anybody has. It's a confidentiality thing. So if you were able to shake that information down about her, it's likely that you at some point had to shake down someone she knows personally. In which case, she does not want to go anywhere. She does not want to be in one of these cells. She does not want to like necessarily lose her job before she can find another one. But the thing that she's afraid of, it seems like, is greater than those threats. So it's not likely that she says, I haven't been to church in God knows how many decades. But that night, she looks around for a moment before she goes on. I saw something. There were these people outside in the yard that were not in prison, and they weren't dressed in the orange. They looked like normal civilians, kind of. One of them's wearing a spooky sheet. Another one looked like some kind of goth chick, and there was a dog. I went to go look at the records, the cameras. It didn't pick up on any of that. Some of them were aimed in that direction, but the footage is blacked out, and when I tried to replay it, the player set on fire. That is not supposed to happen. That is, I just reported it as a malfunction. And the footage itself, I mean, it couldn't be taken anywhere. I don't know what I saw, but it scared the living hell out of me. So, say what you want. Bust me for whatever it is that you think you're going to bust me for, but this is not normal shit. It was like, I don't know, spooky. There wasn't even any trace that they had been there. I checked. And I think somebody would have noticed, you know, a woman in a sheet walking around. But nobody else saw it, as far as I know, or they're not talking about it. I would say with your insight and the way that you have basically what you know about her, she's likely telling you the truth on these things. She does look scared as hell, maybe more scared of those things than she is of you and going to prison. So it seems like actually the main thing that she's afraid of in this case is that you'll think she's insane.
Okay. Well, Blue obviously... Wait. Blue, have we seen... Has Aqua seen the lady with the sheet and all that? I don't think we have yet.
No, you haven't.
Okay. We've seen weird stuff anyway.
You haven't seen the whoever's a goth woman either. Technically, that was Joni and her friends.
Okay. And the dog is not familiar either.
No, the dog you guys actually did run into.
Okay.
A very large black mastiff.
That's what I thought. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well. Thanks for the information. But don't stop looking at those help wanted ads.
She lowers her eyes, nods, and assuming she's free to go, we'll just walk on. She does look quite shaken, and true to her word, she does not look like she slept a wink in the past day, at least. You'll notice that as she leaves, and a lot of the guards are leaving, they also look pretty sleep-deprived. So this has been kind of a big deal at the prison, at the jail. Claudia, you're taking the good cop role. So once the outgoing prisoners are interrogated, you can choose to ask some of the incoming guards about what might be going on, or you can try to go higher up in the management. One's going to be more difficult than the other, but it may yield like immediate results if you choose to go to the upper management supervisors of this jail. The other one will likely help you to build more towards that. So you could basically, supervisors is the shortcut. It's just a little bit more difficult, and you might need to burn more fate die and even take compels if you want to get through that.
I feel like... yeah, go straight to the managers.
Okay, you have... With what Blue has collected and what you collectively bring to the table, you have a +1 invoke for prison knowledge and a +1 invoke for traces of evil. Invoking either one of those could yield different results with different people, so using them wisely will get you the right combination of results. In this case, if you're going to the supervisor, the chain of command in the jail, you likely know who and like what role they are. As you're taking the good cop tact, I will tell you that most supervisors are going to be hostile towards you, but there may be one or two that are not necessarily. So to make that determination as to what you can find, you will need to give me a secret sniffer roll with a passive difficulty of 5. Yep, you can invoke and use one of your boosts, or you can this is a role to determine whether or not you'll find somebody maybe sympathetic to one of your prior causes or somebody that sees you as a pain in the ass for their job. So that one is up to you, but you can choose to invoke and use one of your boosts, or you can even use both boosts if you like. Or you can take a compel and then use a boost. It's up to you.
I'll invoke and use a boost. Let's see. It was traces of evil and what? What else?
Traces of evil and one of your fate points, or traces of evil. Oh,
like what were the other two? What was the other boost?
Oh, the other boost is your knowledge of the prison. So yeah, you can see them right under. I put them under your minor case, so you know. Okay.
I feel like prison knowledge would help more here, so I'd probably invoke that and sunlight.
Okay, prison knowledge and sunlight combined help you to recognize that there is a prison reform advocate working here. They are likely someone that you have spoken to before about conditions of prisoners and maybe even particular merfolk prisoners. Their name is Vitaly Redmond. We'll say that they are fairly experienced in running jails, and it's likely that they were brought on somewhat reluctantly to help and provide better outgoing, incoming prisoner management, so that there are less instances of people either smuggling something in or being intimidated on the way in or out of prison, especially when it comes to merfolk, because they can be very socially vulnerable. Up until the formation of Aqua, there wasn't really a specialized merfolk law enforcement agency of any kind. It was just mostly relegated to the very human police, although there were a few merfolk in the police department at Stella Maurice and in Guam in general. Your Aqua is the first merfolk focused one. So it's likely that someone like Mr. Redmond is an ally that maybe even welcomed the formation of Aqua. In which case, with your good cop approach on these, getting time. First of all, when Redmond knows that you're in the building because he's familiar with you, he actually seems to want to invite you into his office, so you get to go past a few of the more subordinate supervisory employees. And he seems to know exactly what it is that you're here for. Vitaly is, we'll say, an older human, blonde hair, blue-eyed, receding hairline, vastly receding hairline, overweight, but friendly enough. And in a pinch, if you threw a white beard on him and put him in a red suit, he's your mall Santa. Here in this job, however, he just kind of looks like a slightly pink face and even exasperated man behind a desk. He offers you a seat and asks if you want coffee. Would you like him to get you a cup?
Sure. She will basically take a seat and gladly accept a cup of coffee.
Sure. He has his own personal coffee maker in the office. The blend that he drinks, we'll say, is extremely... Well, you watch as he makes you a cup and himself a cup, and then in his own cup, he begins to pour an excessive amount of creamer and sugar. This, combined with his expanding waistline, probably gives you an idea that he has a little bit of difficulty with impulse control and loves sweets. Not hard to tell. But he is, at his core, you know this from, like, speaking to him previously, he is kind of a warm, almost fatherly or grandfatherly figure that is slowly over time been exhausted by the penal system in Guam. What would you like to ask him?
Should probably take a sip of the coffee and go. So, business about that little viral video. Do you have any idea who could have leaked that? I mean, I know here, down here, you're kind of sensitive about that sort of thing. And, you know, it's just such a strange thing to have happen.
He nods his head.
Yeah, it's been all over. We don't know who did this, and there's probably going to be some people that are going to be on their way out of this facility shortly if we don't find anything. I get a feeling somewhere somebody probably knows something or maybe even got paid off, but in a place like this, it's nearly impossible to trace. So that's how they keep getting away with it, and why my job just gets to be more of a pain in the ass. It's hard to assure family and friends of those incarcerated that their loved ones are going to be okay when shit like this happens, whatever this passion play religious thing that they decided to mock up on probably a computer somewhere to send a message or intimidate people. It's a real pain in the ass. He looks down at his coffee and just lets out a very deep sigh. I think I'm getting close to retirement, honestly, Detective Cornell. I think stuff like this is making me want to give up. I mean, you know, not like depression. I mean, I see a therapist for that, but I mean more like, I don't know, find a nice dock somewhere and just fish. Probably wouldn't make any money.
Well, while that's always attractive, you know, some of the inmates do look up to you. You help them out when no one else will. And, I mean, that's worth it all the same. I do get the sentiment, though. And I totally understand where you're coming from. I mean, this case especially has been difficult because, like, who knew someone could have so much reach from so far away? And the kind of pain he could inflict just for things he doesn't want to get caught for.
Vitaly nods his head and then holds up a finger and then brings out a small file and a little tablet computer. Yeah, I'm going to show you something. Press haven't seen it, nobody's seen it, and it's mostly for internal review. We don't really know too much about the rights on this one, considering that the deceased was apparently assassinated by supernatural cause, which, God, I wish I could say that was the first time. He starts to play a video for you, and on the video, it is Rafe Rasputin just being spoken to by a mental health, you know, analyst to see whether or not he needs emergency services after the reported incident, which you will include a file of, speaks on Rafe Rasputin having nightmares in the days leading up to the trial of angels taking him away to heaven. Rafe Rasputin is recorded basically crying, talking to the off-screen analyst and mentioning a crisis of faith. You in particular see a scene where Rafe is just, he also looks tired and like he hasn't slept much. Looking at the camera sadly, with basically tears welling up at the corners of his red eyes, saying, there's no way God's gonna cut us all down for what we did. Everyone's guilty. It says it in the Bible. It says everyone's guilty, right? And every faith in the world has a moment where humanity screwed up, and I screwed up. And I just keep thinking about it. I just keep thinking about how I'm gonna get my comeuppance. And I don't know when it's going to happen. Somebody's just going to stab me somewhere, or they're going to put glass in my food or something. And I screwed up and I pissed someone off, and that's it. No one's going to do anything to help or stop it. It's just disaster after disaster. I can't stop thinking about it. And talking to the chaplain here in the prisons, he doesn't have any answers. He just read the good book bullshit. So I guess I'm just ready to die now. Just want the fear to end. That is the end of the recording.
Who's this chaplain he was talking with? I mean, it doesn't sound like they were being very helpful.
Oh, Redmond puts the tablet down. We have a local guy that comes in occasionally and talks to prisoners. I think his name is James or Joe. I don't really know him too much. I mean, I've been to church a few times, but those, you know, holy roller types kind of weird me out. Here it is. I'm sorry. It's a Father John.
We've had some run-ins with him. Some of my friends have. And he hasn't been too very helpful. That's a shame.
Yeah, well, I mean,
I agree. It is a shame. It seemed like he was having some kind of mental health crisis towards the end, but it always hurts when you find out that your paranoia wasn't exactly paranoia, but a legitimate fear. I mean, it's relieving, but nobody wants to come face to face with that fact. When you combine what he said in these tapes with what happened in the cell, it seems like he might have, I mean, Mr. Rasputin either might have known whoever attacked him, or he just saw it coming somehow. I don't buy much into the prophetic dream stuff anyway. If dreams were real, then I, instead of talking to you, I'd be back in fifth grade trying to take an algebra class I didn't study for, and I forgot my pants, you know?
We've all been there. I get it. I mean, is there even any therapists in this place that would be qualified to deal with him? Because it sounds like it was just a combination of prophetic dreams, lack of mental health care here, and him knowing who his attacker is, and I guess nobody really doing anything once it starts.
Every single therapist that we've gotten in here over the past few months has pretty much quit or been reassigned. So I don't know exactly what's going on with the with our mental health, our clinical staff, but apparently they don't like the place too much. I don't blame them. It is kind of a spooky jail. A lot of people have, you know, spent their last days here. So some people think it's haunted. I'm not much for haunting, though. I'm more of a Christmas guy than a Halloween one.
Halloween has its fun times. You get to dress up as someone you aren't and mess around, throwing eggs on homes and stuff like that. I can see why someone would like prefer that to Christmas, but I definitely prefer the old Yuletide times myself.
Be honest, it's more a matter of practicality. They don't make too many good-looking costumes in a 4X size. Yeah, I should lose some weight.
Or just get a seamstress who knows you.
Yeah, maybe. I mean, I do like giving out candy. Well, anyway, that's about as much as I can probably give you a hand on, at least as far as the Rasputin case goes. It is being handled internally by people that aren't me, you know. In fact, I wasn't exactly warned off or anything, but they kind of made it known that they didn't want too many people looking at this as a matter of liability, as the mom probably has a legal standing to sue. You have to understand that, you know, we have a budget too, and we have to pay out of our insurance for both the wrongful death and any sort of criminal negligence. The higher-ups are not exactly happy with the thought of losing potentially millions, tens of millions of dollars to the legal action here. So limited coverage means limited information. Is there anything else I can maybe help you with today, Detective? I mean, really anything. He kind of fumbles and then reaches and hands you a slim plastic card, business card. I don't know if you have my new number here, but you know, let me just like hand this over. It's possible that I'll maybe need to reach out, or you might need to know more about what it is that we're doing here. But I do want to fully cooperate, of course. I can't give testimony on much without the jail's lawyers being involved, but I can help any way I can.
Of course. I did want to know, like, how, I guess, when did this Father John start to come into this prison exactly? Like what time, I guess, what times and what day he really started to come here?
To be honest, so I looked into him, you know, after I just thought he was weird and maybe just like, I thought he was a smuggler when I first met him. I mean, he's just a weird guy. I thought he was just a, you know, front for getting stuff into prisoners. But if I look back at the records, Father John's been pretty steadily doing preaching here for about the past, 10 years or so. I mean, the records show that. We have him on the logs as initially one of the interested in a mental health position, then more in a religious, like preaching services, ministering. He at one point tried to apply to even get on staff, but it's mostly he just acts as an outside consultant. I don't really know that he would be involved in anything involved with this, but as far as I can tell, his record is more or less clean. There is a notable amount of prisoners that he's preached to that have committed suicide, but considering what sort of state they were in when he first started ministering to them, it's not a surprise. It happens a lot here. Some people just lose their hope. We had hoped, honestly, that bringing on, an actual ordained minister type would reduce the occurrence of that. But, it's a thing that we're working on here still. And he has been kind of sticking with it, even though I'm sure it's hit him hard, losing some of those people that he's, a lot of these people were. If I look at some of the documents here, they were supposedly even converted to his particular brand of Christianity, and didn't seem to stick much as far as wanting to live goes. But right. Long history. I can forward you some more information about him if you'd like.
Please do. I would love to know more. He seems like a stand-up guy so far, but you never know. But thank you for your cooperation here. It's been a bit of a mess, let me tell you.
Sure. Yeah. I bet you guys must be real busy. I heard that there's a trial being held for that Director Elfman fellow that Rasputin was connected with. We don't know much about it on the outside, Shadow Court and all, but I'm sure it's taken up quite a bit of your time. Can I walk you out, or do you want me to walk with you? Is there anything else you want to talk about with anyone in here? Because I'm gonna be honest, they're gonna throw up some blockades. Detectives aren't usually welcome here in the back office,
Yes, I know. I think Blue probably. I need to talk with Blue and see where we go from here, but I don't foresee too much longer spending here, hopefully.
Sure. All right. I'll be here in the office for most of the day before I have to, to go on a small trip to one of the holding facilities in the outer one of the outer counties. So,
which one?
Oh, just one on the. Just Turnville, it's a little small jurisdiction, sort of towards the west. Not a big deal. It's just a little holding place for a small town, just a jail for the locals. Their police department apparently has been dealing with a few unexplained things that I should probably look into. But I'm up to my neck in it here, so I don't know how much time I have to dedicate to anything spooky they got going on there. It probably won't take long, but just in case you try to come back, or you can always catch me by the Uzique. He takes out his own Uzique. It looks like a much older, it looks like an older model likely than the one you have, with larger buttons. He's got what you would refer to as an old person phone. Let me just make a note. He starts tapping into his Uzique. That, just to be open for any kind of thing involving Mr. Rasputin. And he puts away his phone. I just want to make sure that I can be there, because I barely knew the guy. But, it's never good when someone you know and you talk to just gets...
Well, I'm not legally supposed to say get killed because it was, you know, technically it's supposed to be a suicide, but, you know, it seems like a murder to me. I'm not a cop or anything. I just seems pretty much like a murder.
Yeah. Did he have any friends here in the prison? I mean, of course, he probably had some enemies given the vast reach of Danny, but did he have many friends here?
Most of the guys he got taken in with got processed to other jails. Some of them are still available, but they're not really... The guards keep them from socializing too much on the case that might, you know, mess with any sort of testimony that they got to give. So for the most part, he kept to himself. He didn't really have too many good friends, and he was alone in his cell when the incident took place. He didn't have a cellmate or anything. So personal friends, I'm not sure.
All right. Thank you. You've been very helpful.
All right. He finishes his coffee and then makes you another one. All right. Here's one for the road. I know you're probably burning the midnight oil like I am. He holds it out to you. You take care now, Detective. I'm looking forward to talking to you again. I know you got a lot of work to do.
She eagerly takes and lifts it up. Thank you. I'm looking forward to it too. Hopefully, this case won't take too much longer of my time, so I can get back to doing the things I love instead of the things I tolerate.
All right. He smiles. Good. That's great. I feel things are going to go well for me. I think things are going to go all right here. I think I'm going to just wrap this up and probably move on to something, you know? Got a good feeling.
Keep up that positive attitude. And hopefully you'll find a nice little spot to retire to.
Yeah. Fishing dock. Me with a pole and a funny hat. A couple room temperature beers or something.
Maybe with Alta cream this time.
Light beer. It'll be light beer. So I'm assuming you probably would leave his office after the goodbye.
Yeah.
As you're walking around the corner and leaving, go ahead and give me a give me a gaze roll real quick. Yeah. Okay. As you are walking down the hallway away from Tally Redmond's office, you see someone in the background walking towards his office, opening the door, looking at you for a moment, stopping. They stare at you. You want to see who it is? You can look. Yeah. You have, with the gaze roll that you have, you can see them clearly. The person you see entering the office and staring at you with a cup of coffee in their hand and a bunch of folders under their arm is Vitaly Redmond.
What?
He walks into the office after you look at him, closes the door.
She's gonna walk back in, because that seems...
When you walk back into his office, you see him looking down at the a folder and just writing a few things. He looks up. Something I can help you with, Detective.
Just a bad sense of things?
What do you mean?
It's just like I saw you here walking into the office a moment ago.
I don't know what you mean. Walking into my own office, yes, but we were having a conversation, and
you were on your way out, right?
Right.
So, did you forget something, or?
It's just, something's weird. That something seems a little off. How about that beer, actually? Like, if you need one of those, I can go get you one.
He looks down at his documents. If you want to go out and get a beer, I don't mind after work, but I can't drink on the job, detective, much as I want to. That's what you're asking about? You want to go get a drink or something later?
Sure.
Sure. I'll get a drink with you. Won't be anything weird, though. You look like you're young enough to be one of my daughters. Starts writing in the document. Go ahead. I got a thing to do. He checks his phone. Yeah, I got a thing I got to do in the afternoon. But after that, I'm free. You just give me a call. He reaches into his pocket and holds out a card. Here you go.
She takes the card. All right. We'll go get that beer later. And she
smiles and nods.
She walks out the door and compares the two cards that she has.
They're identical.
Oh dear.
Vitaly Redmond is in his office as you leave, just writing a few things down in a document. With a blue pen, he has begun to draw over one of the black and white photos in the file that he has, just slowly filling in the eyes. Coloring them from black and white to blue. He's just slowly turning the pen over in a circle, just slowly drawing over and over until the paper starts to tear, and he begins to write on the paper beneath it, just digging the pen in. Your information that you gathered from Vitaly Redmond, combined with what Blue has gathered, Blue, I'm assuming that you would mention the strange woman, dog, women, I should say, multiple women in the yard, the dog, that sort of thing. You would probably bring that up to Claudia.
Yeah, and I like share the information over you, Zeke.
And Claudia would share her information and probably additionally just go, I think someone is probably taking over people here in the fucking prison. Just kind of saw it happen.
Shit. Yeah, that sounds like it.
With your part of the investigation, the two of you still provide those free invokes that the others can use during their investigation, now that you've shared information on I think you used your prison knowledge, right?
Yeah.
That one got burned? Okay. So you still have the traces of evil boost that either one of the other investigations can use to their advantage if they need to. For now, Claudia, this minor case of the death of Rafe Rasputin, you can consider that to be closed. If you want, while there hasn't been an official reasoning behind the appearance of the angel or the hack, you know, your investigation as a police officer into this case is one of those things that'll get like stonewalled. It's hard to find a satisfying closure to this case at the moment. It is just a minor case. Rafe Rasputin is one of many prisoners that have died in this particular jail. So he's not even standout one necessarily. It's just that it was recorded is the thing. So you can consider this closed if you want. You have investigated and found that it's likely to be something involving the Antichrist or associates of the Antichrist. This is not a Dagonite crime. How would you personally choose to, or how do you personally want to treat this? By closing the case, you can naturally like roll it up into a more major case later. Sort of make it an element or aspect of that, such as jail corruption or even something like doppelgangers if you want. But how do you want to handle it as you are the lead detective on the case for Rafe Rasputin?
She will probably officially just consider it closed, but that's only officially.
Okay.
Later, she's probably like, something's going wrong. I can't let this go. I'll have to figure something out for later, but right now, there's no way I can pursue it to how I want to pursue it.
I will give it its own case template and put it under the closed category. It will be, it's more of just that I'm just going to treat as a, you know, like you can come back to it kind of thing, or like a sort of, you know, could be evidence that you include up in a major or monumental case. So it's not exactly like a dead end. It's more of just the matter of what you can exercise at the moment. But it will be there. Moving on to, let's see, next up was, I believe, the sort of questioning of Lucia G. Wild. There's a sunny thing last, but don't worry, Ice Peak, I will give you stuff to do for that anyway.
I mean, it's a little bit suspicious to have Dr. Ice Peak go meet with Sunny and then Rust, who hasn't really been knee deep in it. So I might. Is it cool if we swap out Enya for Rust and Rust can get the technicals with Mikey?
I mean, that is an option, sure.
Sunny's obviously very dangerous.
Yes.
For you, Mikey, in your investigation, we're going to kind of decide on a few things and take a quick 5 to 10, because it's been like 2 hours. But for you, Mikey, it's kind of like a little solo jaunt. So just like with Blue and Claudia, do you choose good cop or bad cop? Rust will just be the other.
I mean, I want to say Mikey would be the good cop, but I'm just trying to imagine Rust as a bad cop per se, and that's kind of funny. But yeah, I don't think Mikey is necessarily going in there with any kind of ill intent. So I think he would go in just his normal kind of laid back self, if anything, wanting to kind of go over what happened and what all that meant, because I'm sure this is his first time as a detective being part of the Shadow Court and seeing what weird rules. Great, those red eyes don't make it worse. Just watching it out of the corner of my eye. I don't think Mikey would come in hostile, because he has no reason to believe that she's done anything to like kind of ruin the case for them and thus make it, you know, a big deal. So yeah.
Okay. There's a special consideration that needs to be given to Rust. He never comes out in the field with you guys for the most part. Normally this would be Towner's job. In which case, Rust, you'll notice, is wearing basically a full body, almost like a burqa. Very thick. He just looks like a shambling black mass of cloth. I mean, Rust could be investigating the what's necessary for Chief Mongo, but I feel like if Towner were here, he'd probably want to be the one doing that, maybe. I don't know. It's more so that you don't necessarily, like, you get to take Rust out.
He needs to go for a walk or his legs will atrophy.
Yes, all eight of them.
All eight.
Or however he's divided his limbs.
Well, two of them did computers, so at least six.
What? You just take a cop car there, right?
Yeah, we would take, just the squad car.
So you're just sitting in the squad car listening to the radio with a just black sheet ghost more or less next to you. Do you give Rust control over the music or do you like commandeer it?
No, I'd let him pick. I want him to be.
You know what he's going to pick.
I know he's going to play Frasier. Mikey is fine with that. They've been living together and he hears nothing but the Frasier theme coming out of his closet at all hours of the day.
Maybe show him some remixes or something.
Then you just hear this for the next half hour in the car, so on loop. If anything it changes about the music, Russ seems to get uncomfortable and shift around, but this music, as you know from living with him, just seems to have a calming effect to him. It's just background noise and ambiance.
It's elevator music, truly.
He seems somewhat excited for some reason. I'm guessing you would want to know why.
I'm sure while driving he would just be like, "You seem pretty excited. Have you met Lucia before or
no?
Are you just excited to get out there in the field? I know it's not the best time for you, but
well, since I have become integrated into Aqua proper, I've decided to finally take the step that I've been greatly afraid of. You see, I had listened to the Frasier soundtrack for quite some time, but actually watching an episode seemed unthinkable to me, like a sort of religious awakening, and I did see the pilot episode of Frasier.
Oh, how was it?
Mind-blowing.
Oh, wow. I'm guessing you saw all of Cheers then first.
I'm sorry, what?
Never mind.
Mikey just keeps driving.
Yeah, there's a moment of silence, and then you hear clicking, almost like a keypad, and then he starts reading up.
Cheers. Series. Predecessor to the hidden media. It has been revealed to me, Cheers, where everybody knows your name. My goodness. Pages upon pages. Bios. Episode summary. Oh, I shouldn't read these. I don't want to spoil things. I must seize an episode of Cheers now. Tell me, Detective De La Cruz, do I need to watch Cheers to understand Frasier? Is this like a religious study of sorts? I need to read the preceding text.
No, I mean, from my understanding, Frasier just showed up in Cheers a lot as a regular at the bar. But then Frasier got his own show.
Incredible. Detective De La Cruz, you have illuminated my world of darkness.
I don't know if that's a good thing or not. I know you have a sunlight sensitivity.
Yes, I meant more in the metaphorical sense, but now that you mention it, knowledge of Cheers has made me uncomfortable. There's a theme song. No. I must at least study the structure of tossed salad and scrambled eggs for at least a year or two before I can move on to studying the structure of the Cheers theme.
Oh yeah, no, take your time. There's a lot of intricacies and knowing that everybody knows your name.
That is such a strange sentiment. Why would they include that in a series about a tavern?
Well, because everybody there knows your name because you're a regular of the bar.
But how would they... If one does not give their name, how could one know? I could go to this establishment, never give any name or alias, no moniker at all, and proceed to never give a name, but yet the song clearly states everybody there knows your name. Now, I'm only going off of the lyrics. Perhaps the instrumental will enlighten me on this.
Oh, yeah. I mean, again, take your time. Don't rush into it.
We'll do exactly that. Oh, but as for our questioning, as you know, I do not typically go into the field, so I feel overwhelmed, but I will do my best. In the episode that I watched of the Frasier show, but not the preceding Cheers, because I need to watch and rewatch the pilot, you know, afraid you understand. For the most part, as I sat through it, I was paralyzed. Took me an hour, I would say, to come out of it. So, quite moving. It haunts me. The small dog. The grandfather or father figure, the old man. Who is he? Why is he in the chair? Well, one thing I learned was that the character, the saintly Frasier Crane, really, truly, nearly biblical in his presentation, meets with opposition to his everyday life of counseling and running a radio talk show, where he, I presume, preaches to the masses on the wonderful meaning of it all. But there was a bit of antagonism. Would it be okay with you if I were to practice a little bit of... I do not wish to be in opposition, but I think that I should try some of the lessons that I learned from that first episode of Frasier during this... during this questioning of this Miss Wilde. I will assist you, utilizing everything I have learned, Detective De La Cruz. Everything in its totality.
Yeah, that's fine. I mean, Frasier was a radio psychologist, right? So that could come in handy.
One last question, Detective De La Cruz, and then I should probably meditate before we arrive.
Oh, no. Yeah, go ahead.
What would you call Detective... What would you refer to Frasier Crane's haircut as being called? I did a research bit on it, but I could not find a name for this hairstyle. It's a horseshoe and a bit like a mullet.
I don't know a lot about hairstyles of the 1990s. I don't know. I could look it up. I mean, it's probably just he had a semi-short cut, but was balding.
Remarkable. If I had hair, I think that I would want to grow it that way. Oh, no, I couldn't.
You can grow it however you want. I mean...
No, I don't grow hair at all.
Oh, you can't even just, like, try? I mean, we're merp people. We can kind of do whatever.
It irritates my sensitive skin.
Oh, I didn't know. I'm sorry.
I am 100% smooth. No thorns, no spines, no hair. Nothing. If a predator were to latch onto me with their jaws, they would likely crush my body.
Well, we'll try and prevent that as best we can.
I trust you, Detective De La Cruz. You will, of course, at the very least, pull my severed torso away from the jaws of a large predator. I know this of you.
I actually survived pretty much that happening to me, so I mean, if anything, you've got great odds too.
Oh, tell me every single detail.
Where to start?
And so I guess he starts with the Battle of Brittany and Mike.
Yeah, yeah.
And goes on to describe, yeah, getting attacked in the air by something he can't see and still to this day does not know what he looks like. And then explaining Tiny Sunny existing on the cells of his skin and watching a civilization advance out of that. And now he is the genesis of an entire species that has gone off planet.
As you were talking and driving, you just hear Russ saying, oh no. Oh, that sounds horrible. That's terrifying. His voice is just getting smaller and smaller as he listens. Until at one point he just goes silent. You can't see him, but occasionally you will notice that his little sheet body shakes a little as he is pondering the horrifying details of what you've told him. He wanted to know, but it has put a great fear in him now, as someone who never wants to leave the house, that this could happen to him at any time. And that's where we will take our break. As you pull up to the law offices, the local prosecutor's office located in the Stalabarese courthouse, parking is validated. And
yeah, I'll say it ends with, yeah, so Sunny told me that they might still exist and want to meet me, but I don't know how they're going to get bigger, because I don't know how Sunny got bigger. It's not like it's a Willy Wonka situation, you know, they could just take her to the taffy room or whatever. But yeah, so, you know, maybe they're in here right now.
And he, like, opens the car door and just gets out.
Rust very carefully gets out and slowly follows, though he... The thought of what you just said seems to be causing even greater fear within him.
Oops.
Those monsters could be there.
Yeah,
anywhere.
Yeah, they're microscopic, like germs. They could be everywhere.
Oh, no.
Poor Rust.
Yeah, that's what we'll do then. We'll take a quick 5 to 10 as Mikey and Rust proceed towards the questioning of Lucia G. Wild. So take a quick 5 to 10. We'll get back to it.
Alrighty.
Be right back.
Leaf tossed salad and scrambled eggs on loop. Oh, if anyone's still here, free fate point to anyone who can actually name Fraser's haircut. I have no idea what it's called.
I think it's literally just a mullet, but with balding.
Hello, I am back as well.
Hello.
All right, Mikey's back. And Rust is here, obviously. So let us get right into the issue of interviewing Miss Wilde. We'll keep it brief. Lucia is always on a schedule.
I feel like that would be something that Mikey also brings up to Rust, that like as they're walking in,
okay, she's going to give you a time limit, and that is exact and strict. Like, she just stops answering and just goes right to the next thing, so you got to have those questions ready.
As you enter Lucia's office, she has a Bluetooth earpiece in, or something equivalent to that for this day and age, probably just Zeke earpiece. She's already talking to one person and typing to another person, then using her phone to hold a third conversation. She looks up at the two of you entering her office, sighs, and says, okay, I'm going to put all of you on hold for 5 minutes exactly. Do not make a mistake. I will be back in exactly 5 minutes. We have quite a lot to review. She shuts down all communications for a moment, except for one Uzique that she kind of taps on the keypad of absentmindedly, seemingly typing out a message. Detective De La Cruz. And she just stares at Russ, who's your spooky little friend.
Hi, this is fellow Aqua Detective Rust. He deals more with our cybercrime and computer division, that sort of thing. He's our techie.
Is that a religious garb, or what is that? She motions to his cloth.
No, he's a vampire octopus. So, unfortunately, he does have a sensitivity to light.
Oh, you mean as well? So, is he a vampire that is also an octopus, or is he a vampire? I think it's a squid.
Oh, I'm sorry, a vampire squid. I may have misspoke. But yeah, he's a vampire squid, not a squid who was also a vampire. Actually, you know what? We're getting lost in the menu. We do have some questions for you, and I know that you're very strict on time.
Sure. I know that you're here probably because of two things. I received a report that Rafe Rasputin was killed in his cell, supposedly committed suicide, but I highly doubt that. You're probably also here because you want to know more about my true identity.
Yes and yes. I mean, if you're not comfortable discussing it, that's perfectly fine. But we did want to speak about the, and he does kind of like an air quotes with his fingers, suicide that was recorded and leaked, and then as well kind of go over the first day of court and kind of strategize on where day two is going.
Right. Well, as far as the suicide goes, the quote-unquote suicide, I will now have to contend with the fact that a mistrial is on the table. If we do proceed with a mistrial, there is a very strong chance that there could be other complications that will arise over the course of the case before we can get another shadow court case put on the schedule, the docket. I would really rather not have to go through that, but it is a little bit unavoidable when witnesses start getting killed, whether it is through suicide or murder.
I guess in real time, is this happening at the same time that Claudia and Blue are at the prison and Enya Nicepeak are talking to Sunny, or?
It looks like it's happening sort of at the tail end, so now's about when you get the music messages from Blue.
Okay, yeah, because I just wanted to know when I would get the information from them that it appears as though someone who would fit the description of Sunny would be the one who showed up last before the suicide. But yeah, if that's the case, then I would present that information as well to Lucia.
She looks.
I had to, you know, we're kind of all split up, but this is the information from the prison that we were able to glean. And then I would essentially just relay all of that to her as quickly as, I guess, inhumanly possible, so that, again, we're not cutting time on the 5 minutes.
She considers some of the information and brings up a few documents on her main monitor lookup. So, just in summary, if you could, are you implying that the individual known as Sonny Fortuna was seen at the prison?
I'm saying, based on the evidence, the video evidence, the signing, eyewitness testimony, it does fit the description of one Sonny Fortuna. I mean, I'm sure there are other people who match the description, who own dogs and have, I don't know, latent supernatural abilities. That could also be him. But unfortunately, he does also get referred to by pretty much anybody that meets him as the Antichrist. And now supernatural beings such as angels are going around and either assisting in suicide or committing straight murder. So that's a thing.
Yes, well, that's not exactly covered in any of the laws of the nation, or probably any nation, so...
Yeah, usually most of them don't have laws to deal with higher powers, and a lot of them use higher powers as justification for them. So, I guess processing an angel will be weird. But hey, you know, humanity's made laws for merfolk pretty quickly, so I guess the realization that angels exist and commit crimes... We'll certainly get legislation rolling.
Perhaps. It will be difficult, of course, to make a solid actual chain of evidence or sort any of that out before we get to put in any of God's angels on the watch list.
Right. I guess with all that information at hand, I mean, how do you feel the first day went? I feel like it kind of got a little wobbly, but I feel like we held on. You seem to, you know, you really laid into Lee like crazy hard. Not that's not a bad thing. I just want to say that. You carried a lot more authority than I thought possible, which is, again, not a dig at you. It's just amazing to behold that kind of. I don't know. I'm sorry. I'm wasting time.
Well, she looks a little uncertain at first. Thank you, Detective De La Cruz. It is a rather difficult job, but Lee Roth is well known in legal circles as being a bit of a pyromaniac as far as the law is concerned. He'd likely burn down every single part of the Constitution or any protective sort of law and confuse and befuddle all attempts to correct it in any way just for a client's sake, which is admirable in some ways and horrifying in others. A defense attorney who will do anything to protect their client is rare, believe it or not. Though I may not truly agree with Mr. Lee Roth and the way that he approaches the law, I cannot fault him for wanting to save his client's skin, or lack thereof, in which case, you know, that is a bit of a difficult thing to do for somebody who is human and has to work on the defense of, well, what is really an eldritch horror. In that regard, and to get to the point that I'm sure you would maybe like to know, yet no, my name legally was not Lucia G. Wilde before I took up an oath of servitude to the Harmonizers, and in particular to the Kellitite Harmonizers, the followers of the doctrine of Kelly Krukut. I changed my name, went to law school, and got a successful career It was part of the oath, and I do not regret it, but there are times when that can become a difficult thing, such as when you are being questioned by a judge who will cut your fingers, arms, and eventually your head off if you tell a lie. Legally speaking, there are always ways to bind those who are in accordance with the law. It is a matter of knowing the difference between the truth and what needs to be known. You, Detective De La Cruz, have been an asset as well in this investigation, so I appreciate you checking in on me. I hope you understand that this time the time limit that I've placed on our conversation is not one due to a lack of interest, but more one of necessity. I am currently being slammed. The Rafe Rasputin thing is going very, very viral right now. There are a lot of people who want to know exactly what the hell happened, and quite frankly, I'm getting a little bit tired of people just telling me that they are very spooked or scared. Yes, tiresome, to say the least. These are people that I'm supposed to be able to count on, and now they are, well, I won't call them Chicken Little, because it is quite frightening what was in that video, but it's not quite what I would call the law.
Oh, no, I fully understand. I guess, out of character, anybody watching the video can see the angel?
Yes.
Okay, so it's not a stand, necessarily.
Maybe.
I was gonna say because typically a stand can only be seen by other stand yes. users. Okay. Because I was gonna say because a video alone of somebody suddenly hanging themselves is already kind of a bad thing. But yeah, having an angel show up, a little bit weirder. So yeah. Okay. Of course, I fully understand. Again, we're just trying to, I guess, figure everything out. I'm supposed to be hearing back from Dr. Icepeak and Enya. They were going to go follow up on some leads, unfortunately, with Dorobo, which, with all the other information we have, seems like leading right into a trap. So I may need to go there next after this meeting. Just to help.
Of course, you have to make sure that they do not die. According to you, they are dealing with the embodiment of evil. I do acknowledge Sonny Fortuna has very antichrist-type properties. They are a little concerning. Did not appreciate the severance of... she holds up her bandaged hand. This, for example...
Oh, yeah, no. I didn't know... I mean... Everybody keeps saying it, so it seems, so I didn't really, but that, calling somebody the Antichrist and then being the actual Antichrist are two different things. Like, what's the probability that you would run into the actual Antichrist?
She looks at her timer. It is at exactly 5 minutes. And then she picks up her earpiece, speaks into it. One more minute. And then you hear yelling over the speaker as she places it down again. I'm breaking my own rules to talk about this, but I feel it is rather important to mention. The figure known as the Antichrist, whoever he may be, historically speaking, because I've looked into this sort of thing before, there have been several. So, in any speech that you may have heard along those lines, that was not an inaccurate assessment of the situation. The Antichrist is more of a title, more of a designator. Of someone who opposes the initial values of the Christ or Savior. Now, I don't think I need to tell you this, but the world doesn't necessarily operate off of Christian dogma. We live in a world where Buddhism, Islam, Paganism, Sikhs, I mean, there are numerous other religions. They could all be just as valid. It would be ridiculous to assume that there is one monotheistic view of the world. But in each of those faiths, more or less, there is a sort of savior figure, and there is an opposition to that savior figure. So if we look at it in a sort of historical sense, or even an anthropological one, there are many examples of a figure who could be called an antichrist, just as much as there are those who could be called a Christ or a savior figure. Depending on which type of savior we are talking about, this could be a social, or it could be a religious and spiritual opposition. But either way, simply being called the Antichrist or even calling yourself the Antichrist doesn't necessarily confer any sort of supernatural ability, such as assassinating someone inside of a cell with an angel. That would be something a little bit more extensive. As a
knows.
A little bit. I don't think I need to tell you that as a harmonizer, I don't necessarily believe in the single Yahweh monotheistic type of pantheon. There are many different types of spirits that one can talk and commune with and take lead from in the lunar pantheon, as we like to call it in the faith. Accordingly, if there was an Antichrist, it would have to be someone in opposition to presumably all of them, as they are a varied bunch. Technically, that person could be anyone. I would even suggest that the more likely candidate would be someone like Post-Valentine, for example. Fits more into the religious understanding of what an Antichrist would be, as he is attempting to swallow everything up into the Seven Nation Army banner. Or you could look at other figures throughout history that have likely been in that vein. They could all be a type of Antichrist. It seems a little bit ridiculous for that one person to take up the mantle. I mean, how powerful can one person be? Absurd, really.
I mean, I guess given the right circumstances, I mean, somebody could be in charge of a lot of things. I mean, look at Director Danny. I mean, he's a crown of VG. He's a, you know, that makes him, you know, essentially like a Dagonite Pope who was in charge of a PMC that was receiving shadow funds and creating super soldiers out of, you know, super tech that isn't seen anywhere else in the world and is entirely proprietary to them.
When you put it like that, you make him sound like a bit of a comic book villain, which would be concerning.
It does seem a little silly, but I mean, it's the truth. And you just kind of use a shrug.
you are not entirely incorrect to make that assumption. On that matter, and before we run out of time, because there is so little of it, there is the matter of the petition for extradition to Atlantis. I'm not quite sure how to deal with this particular matter because Atlantis may, in fact, have a legal claim to what happens to Director Elfman ultimately. That includes if they want to execute him.
Oh. Yeah, about that. If they do try and extradite him, or if, you know, there are any, I guess, any claim to him, I don't know if you can help with it, but I do request that Aqua be the team to take him. I mean, Dorbo, I'm assuming since they're holding him, will also try and want a vested interest, but I prefer that Aqua be sent, as we are merfolk who represent the laws of Guam. Making our way, delivering a prisoner to them feels right, and also we do have one of our own who was from there, so, you know.
Of course. I think that would probably be best, and it seems that you are all at least physically capable of ensuring that his security would be top-notch. I will definitely make a consideration for this and make sure that somebody listens to what I have to say on the matter.
Yeah, thank you. That means a lot. We have a new captain who is mostly secluded to their office, so it's been kind of hard running things by them.
New captain. Strange. What happened to the old one?
He asked us about the case, and we told him, and he retired.
Ah, yes, that happens with what we in the religion refer to as old world thinkers, new world thinkers, which is the sort of philosophy that I subscribe to, are a bit more adaptable when it comes to strange circumstances, a little less likely to look away when there is something strange or upsetting about the events that one is currently facing. That is part of why I think the harmonizers will eventually be the enduring faith of this period. Samurai will likely not last, and I don't know that Daganism will either, but I believe harmonizers have the potential to adapt to many different types of circumstances and thoughts. We've even resigned ourselves to the eventual death of the Egregore if that should happen. We do not know what will happen with them. Philosophically speaking, they could die, all merge into one consciousness, or may have already done so. It is not really as relevant as the ideals which they present and the ideals which they propose.
Right. I don't know a lot about the newer religions, obviously. I try, but, you know, it's all a lot. But thank you for your time, and thank you for the extra minute. I know that's not something you do. We'll stop taking every time. Rust, did you have any questions?
Rust has been quiet the whole time. He finally speaks up.
You're going to answer our questions or we're going to get angry.
She leans forward. What did you say? I couldn't hear you through your sheet, sir.
Rest, we don't, that's not how, not all interrogations are like TV. Like he puts, like he actually puts a hand on like his shoulder and is like, because he would hear him as like an eye scout, which is, what do you, no, it's okay, you don't.
We should, Detective De La Cruz, we should take her downtown and then she'll crack.
She's a lawyer. She's our lawyer. Are you watching crime dramas?
I should thank you for your time.
He just slowly shuffles towards the door.
Mikey will like watch him start shuffling and then turn to Lucy and just go, he
said thank you for your time. He had no questions. Thank you.
Oh, that's fine.
He doesn't get out a lot. It's the sun thing.
Sure, yes.
He was really excited, so you know.
It's a smile, but it's like too wide because he's there's a little bit of him forcing it. So because of like his inhuman nature, it looks a little weird.
We'll see you in court. Bye.
Of course. Goodbye, Detective Rust. She just kind of says it like slowly, like goodbye, Detective Rust. By Detective De La Cruz. And then she puts her earpiece back in.
Yeah. He waves as he like slowly closes the door on their way out. And he's like, you did good.
I did. We got all of the information and the questions were right. Yes.
Yeah. You know what? You did such a good job. You didn't even have to ask a question. She folded immediately.
Yeah. You think, wow, that's,
that's. He kind of like walks with a little more confidence in his stride.
Well, a learned man has a sort of intimidating presence sometimes. I figured because there are notably, Dr. Crane has this sort of, he's nice height and stature and, you know, immediately has a presence, just commanding presence.
And I mean, he's able to do all of that psychological work just over the radio. And that's, such an old, outdated form of communication even then. So that's got to mean something.
Good. I quite enjoyed being the bad cop. Yeah, I was good at being a bad cop.
Mikey gives a big smile again. He's like,
Towner also puts on a big tough guy act. So you may want to ask, get some more lessons from him. I'm kind of always the good cop by default.
But he possesses rows of teeth, and mine are merely circular. I don't... perhaps I could try.
Oh, well, if that's the case, then you may want to talk to Icebeak. She doesn't...
And he kind of, like, squints. And he's like,
I wouldn't say she does bad cop well. She just kind of is a cop. She does her own thing.
Yes. She's a little weird.
Well, I mean, she's, we're all kind of weird.
And he does kind of look at like Rust, I guess, like in the elevator or whatever, and then like at himself in the reflection.
Yeah, we're all kind of weird.
Oh, I feel quite normal.
As the elevator's closing.
Yes, I do think I am the normal. I'm this bit straight man. I feel.
Oh, okay. Well, then, I mean, if you're the straight man, then I guess I gotta be the fall guy, right?
Yes, I suppose you would be the... Oh. You are the Niles to my Frasier. How is that? Niles is quite an interesting fellow, actually. I think he may be a trickster god of some kind.
He says as the doors are closing.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean... Yeah. Totally... I haven't seen a lot of Frasier.
You must simply see
the scene in which I feel the veil and mask slip, and we see the chaotic Niles, the raw primordial Niles. He will, as you are leaving, give an in-depth explanation as to how Fraser is the more patriarchal, even godly or saintly figure, while Niles is a sort of opposition or antagonist in many ways, though appears to be a friend. Yes, he seems to take the view that Niles is the opposition in many ways. But that is, yeah, that's where we will leave the two of you, as you are, I assume, on your way to meet up or eventually check in with Ice Peak and Enya, who have gone to in question Sunny Fortuna. Well, he's only seen the one episode.
I was just about to say, he's got a lot to learn.
Claudia and Blue, where would you have gone after the after your trip to the prison?
I mean, where do you think, Blue?
I guess the others are they, where are they questioning these people?
We'll have to establish that, but I'm going to say tentatively a museum that Sunny Fortuna is visiting as part of a Dorbo Lenout art exhibit.
Okay.
It's a sort of sponsored thing that they're setting up.
I guess either they are just back to the police station.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah, that makes sense.
All right. We will get to we'll get to that then. So for Enya and Ice Peak, attempting to question Sunny Fortuna means going to the Parsons Museum, located in the cultural district of Stella Maurice. That is where Sunny Fortuna can often be found, either at the theater house, the museum, art gallery, that sort of thing.
Well, I like those places.
Oh, God. So we're just, did we arrange to meet up with them, or?
Yes. Well, I guess, how would you get in contact with them to know where or when to meet up with them? I'm assuming iSpeak would reach out.
Yeah.
I could ask about his arm. It's the removal of his arm. But yes, I would arrange this.
Okay. He will tell you that that is where he will be. He mentions that he has a private room that he is setting up, and that he can be found in the we'll say the Sirius wing of the Parsons art gallery. There, once you arrive, you'll find that there are, yes, it's Sirius, like the satellite, the star. He has, first of all, the museum is barely occupied once you arrive there. There are a few people working to set up exhibits. There is a small part of the Sirius wing with what looks like some Dorbo employees, bastards, cracking open a crate. And you see Sunny watching them as they do it. Once the crate is opened up, you see within what looks like the statue of a gargoyle. The first thing that you'd notice other than the sight of it is that it smells like something burning, and there is a small bit of smoke being emitted from the lips, blackened lips of this twisted figure, a sort of monstrous human. Sunny stares at it. You can see that he is on his cane and that his arm, the one that was cut, is still empty in the sleeve. He's simply staring at this gargoyle. Fascinating. Maybe I should put this in the garden after the exhibition is over. It's hideous. Grotesque, even. Perfect. One of you can be the good cop or bad cop in this situation. Who wants to be the good cop and who wants to be the bad cop?
I'll be bad cop.
Alrighty.
Pretty obvious. I never liked... Well, yeah. I
think it's obvious. You are to an Antichrist, a paladin is the bad cop, yes.
Yes, your sense, I would say, Enya, immediately, is whatever the statue is, it feels cursed. Like, it's not moving, but it feels like there's a person in there. And the expression is so one of such anguish that it's hard to imagine an artist would really be able to capture this so perfectly. So it almost seems like there's just a person trapped in stone.
Enya's going to be staring at that gargoyle for a moment. She's kind of hoping that Ice Peak is going to introduce them.
Ice Peak would slide up and put her fingers to her chin, observing it. Yes, he looks in agony.
Oh, hello. Yes. Yeah, this was acquired by a few employees of mine who said that they retrieved it while on a salvage mission. Apparently it was on an abandoned property, something like a church. No one was there to claim it, and so I thought it would make a nice decoration for somewhere around the eventual embassy that I plan to create here in Guam for the nation of Japan. Not sure what to call it. What would be a good name for something like this? Weirdly, he motions to the face. The lips emit a smoke as if burned.
Perhaps it is still burning hellfire inside?
Or the last kiss that a demon received before being cast in the pit by the angel. Well, who can say? I'll have to come up with a good name for this one.
Names are... they seem like a personal sort of thing. I'm sure you'll think of something nice. But it's actually a pretty good segue. I've been meaning to ask you something about Japan and your employees.
Oh, is this about the trial? I thought I had been excluded due to the legal action that took place on the day of the trial. I can't help but to think that my part in it is mostly done. But what question might you have?
It's more general. I remember you saying something about Japan resetting every day. That still holds true, right?
In a way, though the people that are afflicted by curses tend to remember what happened to them, there are times when the mind is only so elastic and, well, you just start to forget and start to believe the dream, which is often the case there. It's hard to pull them out of their state of mania at times.
Would you say that when this tower that Doribo owns, when it's parked in Japan, it's under that effect?
Well, the tower itself tends to be warded against the greater effects of curses. Why do you ask?
It just got me thinking. There's a possibility that Shaw Dades might still be alive. Same for a certain Elder Reyes. Definitely the latter, anyway.
Oh, I checked. Elder Reyes is no more.
You found a body?
Yes. We found a body.
Did you report it to his family?
The attempts to make any communication with the Reyes family have mostly been fruitless. They are hostile. However, I am assured that a certain Don Reyes would eventually come to collect.
You've been assured?
Well, through my contacts in the Seven Nation Army, yes.
I speak Stephens. I'm not sure that is who he would wish to retrieve the body.
It is not up to me. It is a matter of family, after all. Family is important.
Does Dorbo have that body in its possession right now?
We do. Why? Do you want to do an examination?
Anya's gonna look over at Icepeak.
I would like that.
In time, then. Currently it's being held cryogenically, so the process of thawing it out would need to be handled carefully. Although, you may be pleased to know, I have made great advances in preservational technologies. Great advances.
That's... I believe that. We would appreciate it, considering his death was in a scene that we were involved in directly.
Right. Sure.
Next question. Yeah, Dorbo still employs mostly just bastards and the deceased, right?
Oh, we have been expanding our roster and actually have acquired quite a few new employees. Funny you should mention it.
Wow. Change of plans, huh? Expanding out?
In a way. Strangely, I would say, it seems that those employees have been finding their way to Dorbo's doorstep, wherever we may be. It's almost as if they have been waiting to join an organization like this. Strange. But they're good fits and quite good employees, I think.
A mental image of Father John flashes in her mind.
Is it so strange with the rumors flying about?
Well, he starts to walk towards another part of the wing. What rumors might those be about the witch?
About you.
Oh, me, yes. Well, there are some who go in for the religious angle. A seen and be seen kind of benefit of working with someone that's seen as the Antichrist. And quite frankly, my stock is rising politically. Once I took on becoming the ambassador for Japan, it became more notable, I think, that, well, people have needed a figure like this, a more stable, calm, understanding, energetic, technically minded sort of leader. Not that I consider myself anything of the type. But graciously, I will accept the world's nomination if ever given. It can't just be the Valentines running things, after all. The world needs other leaders, and Dorbo is a corporate leader of many different sectors. Walk with me, won't you? He starts walking along with his cane past other pieces of art that he's collected.
Right, leadership. Speaking of taking leadership, have you been able to tie up any sort of rogue workers that are the source of ozone getting to the population?
Ah, your concerns of ozone.
You previously only employed bastards and, again, the deceased, so you would probably have a pretty good handle on the root of that, I would think.
Indeed. I feel like there is, yes, a sort of need to approach the initial ozone problem. The fact that it was distributed to the population, the various issues with addiction, and although the supply is, of course, cut off now, ozone cannot be acquired freely. I've made sure of it. There's still the lingering effects on society that need to be addressed, but that is true of almost every addictive drug. I don't even know that ozone is all that different from the heroines or methamphetamines of the prior centuries. They just need to be studied, understood, and controlled, which Dorbo will assist with.
Well, that sounds perfect. I'd hate to open an investigation just for ozone. But if you're willing to cooperate...
Of course. I would also hate for there to be any investigations that could tie up the corporate actions and progress that we've made so far. So if there's really anything I can do to assist you, I certainly will do that. I am very willing to do what is necessary to ensure that Dorbo continues to do what Dorbo does.
Dorbo would be pretty aware of its competitors. Do you know of any other company that might be experimenting on merfolk? Other than... She just kind of stares at him.
Do you mean ethically or unethically?
Either.
Well, in either case, I can do my best to research into the matter, although I am a very hands-off individual when it comes to, well, turning your kind into lab rats. It doesn't need to be done on such a large scale, I think. But if you are curious, I can maybe forward some information on other entities that may be interested in researching the biology of merfolk and the potential that they have in what I would assume are life-saving drugs and transplants even at some point. The hybridization that was being researched by my predecessor might have been geared towards such a thing, I imagine.
Have you... You've been in Guam long enough. Have you heard of the Madonna of Guam, by any chance?
He pauses in front of a large triptych, which looks like Hieronymus Bosch's Garden of Earthly Delights. And in fact, may be the original. Madonna of Guam. The name does sound familiar. Something I've heard whispered about, mentioned in rumor. I assume it's some sort of religious figure linked to the Dagonite faith.
People have turned up with amnesia and medical bracelets on. Recently. Just wondering if Dorbo might have anything to do with it. You seem pretty enmeshed in symbolism of your own these days.
It happens with the turning of every age that there are those who propose the world will end and others who say that it will be saved and brought to a new age, a golden age of enlightenment, or something of the sort. Personally, I believe Dorbo will lead the way towards that enlightenment. An understanding of the environment and ways to repair it, a new cultural bridge between our kind and, well, the... And I use the term extremely carefully here. Crypto-species. Merfolk being one of them. Cloud giants, harpies. Sasquatch, I have heard. Thinking sentient beings, near human, but not quite. Different. But similar.
Huh. With that in mind, what do you think of Atlantis?
Well, I've never been there, but I imagine that it is quite lovely and filled with people who probably have a different understanding of the world than those on the outside. What I know of Atlantis is that it is a, well, as close to a utopia as we are likely to achieve.
Isn't that what you want, Sunny?
Yes, of course. A place where people don't need to worry about hunger, crime, pain, maybe even eventually death would be nice. Who doesn't want that sort of perfect home?
Sunny Fortuna.
Yes.
You are not thinking of selling my world to these cryptids, are you?
Well, I'm not sure what you mean by selling your world. After all, no one is in possession of the world to begin with, so selling a world is rather difficult. Did you have something on your mind in that matter?
Yozan already said that you intend to re-terraform the world, so it does make one wonder.
Wonder what exactly? What is it that you are attempting to pin on my character, I wonder?
Enya looks to Icepeak.
I have had one home sold out under me from Dorgo. I do not wish for another.
Oh, you're referring to the Russian project, are you?
I lean in and say, yes, yes, I am.
An unfortunate event, one which could not be foreseen, I'm sure, but I was not in control when it occurred. What do you wish for? Restitution? Financial restitution, perhaps?
I simply do not wish it to happen to Guam. I do not want your money.
More like, what is it that you want, Sunny? Are you trying to get to heaven yourself? Are you trying to create new shareholders? Create some sort of new family for yourself? Or, yeah, we know about the Brotherhood.
The Brotherhood? Oh. You saw something somewhere, didn't you? Something that told you something about me and my goals. You saw information, perhaps, that you would have not otherwise been savvy to. Interesting. I have a question for the both of you. Would you like to join me for a light lunch?
Sure, a light lunch, why not?
He leads you towards a more closed off part of the wing where there is a table set up and three plates with placements of forks and spoons and has a seat at the head of it and then motions to you, the both of you, to take a seat as well. Believe it or not, I have made some preparation for you to join me here, so it pleases me that you would accept. I feel we maybe have a thing to discuss, something that has been on your mind likely for a while. But first, before we get to business, please, he motions to the seats. We are having a very rare delicacy today, and I would be honored if you would be try it with me. I have made considerations for your dietary concerns, Dr. Icepeak.
I will fly these into a seat. It will more meet me, like my leg lamp raise will pull it in so that I can sit down with it moving.
Mm. Once you are sat around this table, you'll notice the lights are dim here in this part of the museum, and the candlelight on the table is really what gives it the most illumination. So in this part, really, it's Sunny who is well lit, and everything else seems to be dark around him. He sits carefully, puts his cane down, and tucks a napkin into his collar, bib almost. Now, you are curious about a few things. My goals, for one. A valid thing to have questions on, I think.
I speak nods.
You want to know what it is that I plan to do. Lunch, supper, meal served. He motions towards an incoming figure who just kind of weirdly drifts from somewhere off behind him into the side. You see as a very tall woman with a ghostly sheet is kind of sliding across the floor with a covered platter. She places it in the middle of the table with very long, graceful limbs, and then carefully plucks the top off of it, revealing several cuts of what look like raw meat. And a cup is placed before you, Ice Peak, of blood. Though you've never quite seen blood like this. It looks almost oily and mixed with different shades of red. Even there's a little green in it, even. This is my personal chef. The woman just stands quietly behind Sunny. Her name is Alsatia, and she recently came to work for me. Her credentials, her skills are peerless. I was quite surprised, but she insisted that she would be the right fit as my own personal chef. And so, what could I do but say, of course, most notably, Alsatia will probably accuse me of flattery on this, but her all-white visage, never stained once by any splatters of the food that she makes. It's remarkable, really. Well done, Alsatia. This looks delicious. The woman in white bows deeply to Sunny and then slowly drifts backwards into the darkness. Now, this meal, he points to the chopped meat that's basically raw. This is whale sashimi, a delicacy in Japan, actually. Whaling was a hunting privilege for many, many years in Japan. They have a long history of eating whales and dolphins. But it was eventually outlawed. And as you know, many of the whales in the region gone extinct. This one, however, is different, taken from a new region, an expedition that my company took out to greater oceans. It is a sort of new species of whale. Now, it was captured, of course, for scientific research purposes, but it would be a shame to let the meat spoil, and so I decided that I would try and, well, research it for cloning to see if it had any nutritional value. I suspect that it could be quite good as a replacement protein for many areas of the world where livestock simply is not an issue or an option. Please enjoy. He motions towards the sashimi before picking one up with some chopsticks that he has with his remaining hand, taking one thin slice and placing it on his own plate.
Hope to farm whales?
No, in time we wouldn't need to. We could just clone the meat with no pain or anything of the sort. Machines will help to tenderize and build muscle tissue, and
Any complexities that need to be issued therein will be handled as well, including a full spectral analysis to ensure that there is no growth of parasites or genetic defects that could lead to any complications when this eventually, I would hope, goes into mass production. Now, I have not yet sampled this particular meat, but I am assured that it will be quite tasty. And yes, it is whale blood.
How sad does it taste?
Give me a... Give me a leech roll. You can taste the despair.
I take one sip and then move it away from me.
Are you all right if I pray before eating?
Of course.
Okay. Enya's gonna, like, push the chair back and straighten up and close her eyes. Oh, most high laser hawk of the bluest sky.
No, he holds up his hand.
Who made the beautiful lunar empire?
I would like it if you didn't do that.
She claps her hands together in prayer, and for a brief moment, Holy Diver briefly flashes like a porous mesh framework over her, and some of the liquid light sprays. And she just gets on one knee in supplication. Is Sunny, like, really...
He removes his glasses and then starts to pinch the bridge of his nose.
We ask for your blessing to avoid manipulation and to keep clear our path towards order.
Are you finished?
She decides to keep going. A blessing in any form is something. It's all I ask. A promise that there are merfolk willing to work with the laws of the land, and with time and guidance, that'll become more obvious to you up in heaven. She gets up. Yeah, I'm done. I just thought I'd try that. Finding religion of my own, you see.
So, that's how it is, is it? I think I can read the room well enough. You're not praying for my safety or my success. You're praying for the opposite. You're praying that your God will come down and deal with me, aren't you?
Of course not.
Wise. He stares at you, Icepeak. This is really what you've brought to me, then. This sort of circus sideshow. Right in my face over a meal. That's... If I could be honest, hurtful.
It's not her.
Sunny Fortuna, can you be hurt? Can you feel pain? Can you feel sadness?
What sort of questions are these? You believe them, that I... You believe that I am the Antichrist.
Yes.
You...
I think you can choose to be the Antichrist, and I'm wondering if you will. So far, I like what you have said, but I do not believe you keep a close eye on your followers who ravage prisons and kill men.
Oh, so I'm just incompetent. And I don't feel... He takes his napkin from his collar and just starts wiping his mouth and places it down. I think I've had enough of the whale sashimi. I think that I am
Yes, done. It tastes of despair. It's... I also stand.
Delicious. You, both of you. I have done everything that was asked of me by your group. I have contained the crowns that have been captured. I have not made overt moves, and I have restrained power so as not to be tyrannical or evil or sinister. And here you are, he motions to Enya, praying to somebody that, as far as I know, would like me dead, or see me dead. And you, he motions to Icebeard, have you never been accused of being heartless and cold yourself? How does it feel, especially from someone that you thought you could trust?
Trust? You've been nothing but facade after facade, Sunny Fortuna. We're law enforcement. If people like us don't point out how people can't just own whatever they want, where's the resistance?
He fishes a Uzique out of his pocket. The resistance. Right here. Presses a button calmly. You can see the dialogue on the screen is doing send with a loading bar. You have made your allegiances quite clear to me, and accordingly, I have a contingency plan for this sort of event.
I will miss pretending with you, Sunny Fortune.
I wish I could say the same. The information that I have just sent is the full review and admission of all of Dorbo's plans, including those involving Soft Cell, to the public square. They will not only know in full exact detail what Soft Cell was up to, they will also know of Dorbo's involvement in those fine, fine escapades into war crimes, into experimentation, into involvement with the Vici's followers. Your discussion with me on these matters about coming clean have certainly been intriguing. I think I should put them to the test now. He looks down at his watch. You can see a second clock face spring out from the side and begin a timer.
Why?
Now, what do you mean, why?
How is that a contingency plan for you?
He looks down at the timer. I suppose you're about to find out, detective. And then there is a loud boom somewhere outside of the museum in the cultural district. Oh. It seems that the fireworks are starting. You see, I have been observing quite closely the social temperature, as it were. Between the tensions that arose in the trenches after the Soft Cell incident and the general anxiety that the populace is feeling, well, you can imagine the people are a little tightly wound, so the information that just went out, including highlighted, bullet-pointed notes on what, where, when, and why these things occurred, well, they speak to a certain narrative. That narrative being that there is an oncoming war and social disorder, of course. And they wouldn't be wrong. The infiltration of a private sector military contractor in the government, including, by the way, highlighted pictures of the Prince of Guam being involved, tied into, and blackmailed by... There's a second explosion. Ooh. He holds the glass of blood that you
that you didn't want to drink so that it doesn't tip over when the whole museum rocks for a second? Close one.
So, you're just unleashing madness? You're just gonna unravel this whole delicately planned out... She slams the table. Ugh.
Oh my goodness. No, not quite. Let me tell you exactly what I am, detective. This may come as a bit of a shock, but Sonny Fortuna is, as you know, not my real name. My name... There isn't one. But no. If you... Yes.
So you no longer go by Leroy, I would hope.
Leroy, Sonny Fortuna, Yozan Hamamoto. Many names. But truly, I do not have a name to be called. Never given one. Never needed one. When you are busy dealing with the... He looks down at the watch timer. With the riots. And you're angry about it. You're wondering who to curse. You won't have a name to curse. You could say Sonny Fortuna or Leroy. It wouldn't matter. You can pray to your laser hawk all you want. He kind of motions dismissively to Enya. He won't hear you. Nobody will hear you. You see. As I said, contingency plans are for exactly this situation. When, and this may seem like a bit of a shock, but Softcell performed a suborbital launch and manned satellite, it also gave the capability of dispersing certain particles that make communication between Earth and Moon a little difficult. In other words, these gods, if they exist, as you think of them, are blind. They couldn't possibly see through the quantum haze. And that figure will continue to energize such a field. And good luck finding a human-sized dot in the inky black abyss. Now, it also has the added benefit of allowing for the direction of solar energy resources, which we will use for the renewables that will be planted in certain parts of the world. So, not entirely a wash. Actually quite beneficial. We could regulate seasons better, for example, reduce water temperature gradually over time, and repair the ozone layer. And as an added benefit, communications with the moon are a little bit hindered anyway, why not just black them out entirely? So no, the Laserhawk won't be appearing.
It is good. I have never relied on the gods. I'll send it. Excuse me, I believe my morgue will be full.
That it will. You detectives, you can have a good rest of your day. I do believe you have a trial that you need to attend to, so not likely you'll have a whole lot of time for me at this point. Maybe I'll just make my own way from now on to where I want to be. If you wish to speak to me, I have many representatives who would be willing to talk to you in my place, and they can provide you with any information that you require. But legally speaking, unless you are wanting to issue a subpoena of some kind, then I am under no obligation to answer any other questions you might have, even if I were.
Yes, I'm sure your minions will attempt to kill us a second time.
Second time? I don't remember the...
Second time!
Sorry, I don't think I'm aware of that.
Well, the next time I have to pull crows out of my skin, you will keep that in mind. Excuse me.
Still gotta play the law of the land. Excuse me as well.
As you're leaving, he says to you, Enya, you don't have to. You don't have to at all.
That does give her pause.
You could. This is a compel. Kill me right here if you really wanted to. You pay a fate point or you accept the compel.
She's going to accept the compel.
I mean, that means getting violent with him right away.
Oh, God damn it. I'm going to pay the fate point. Ice Peak's right here. It's not a good thing to do at all.
Okay, how do you respond?
I'm still on the job.
But everyone has a use, Detective Orinoco. What is yours? It seems to be a sort of muscle, a brute force. And what brute force could be better used than to stop the supposed Antichrist that is right here in the room? Well, you could if you wanted, couldn't you? You could easily crush my skull and end my life. What remaining part of my brain was the supposed Leroy's, would be annihilated. You will be the hero to your, what was it? This Madonna of Guam. Well, she's in danger too, isn't she? Don't you want to protect the innocent detective? That's another compel. He's now compelling your crusader mentality.
She's gonna look over her shoulder and glare at him.
I would like to smack Sunny across the face.
You're just gonna smack him?
Yeah, just smack his glasses right off.
Okay, you smack him. Go ahead and give me a... give me a sterilize roll. You smack him. He is smacked. His glasses do fly off. He rubs his face. He wipes a small bit of blood away from the corner of his lip and then rubs it between his fingers. If you wanted a drink, you could have asked.
You're lucky the lady is so civilized. I don't know why you're... Doctor, I speak. Let's just go.
Yes, I must fix the mess that has been created.
Indeed.
She is staring a bit. Okay, let's go.
You notice as you're leaving, this woman in white is rushing out towards you, but Sunny puts a hand out and stops her. And she just stands there kind of like floating in a very menacing manner, but Sunny is not letting her proceed. For now, you were no longer, I mean, if there's been many times when you haven't been on good terms, possibly with Sunny, but it's pretty, it's getting pretty bad now. Because what he said is accurate. You see outside that there is a car that has crashed, and one very near the museum, and a second one, actually. So there's two cars that have crashed into electrical poles. And there is a loud murmur outside as the news is lighting up people's phones, people like various media outlets, like television stations inside of cafes and bars are playing this report of a very large document dump that has occurred from an unknown anonymous source. The breaking headlines here are that, well, there's quite a bit. Softcell was involved in the trenches operation. They were told to target merfolk specifically. There is mention of a Madonna of Guam in these, that she is in Guam and has a strange and rare genetic potential. There's information on the various operations that Softcell has been involved with around the world. And the fact that Director Elfman had blackmail materials on just about every single notable politician in Guam, including the royal family. This information still needs to be processed and distributed, but you can already hear in the streets that there are people sounding very worried and concerned. Like, this is the cultural district, so they're a little bit more rich and bougie than the people you'd run into in other parts, but there are a lot of very anxious whispers and people hurrying to be with their families or prepare for something. Okay. And that is... Well, go ahead.
No, that's where we're ending, right?
Yes, that is where we're going to end. Detective De La Cruz and Rust, their car is stopped by a small mob in the streets. Has begun to crowd the road. And Claudia and Blue are also a little isolated as, a fire begins to rise in one of the storefronts on a street that you are driving on currently. Like it looks like somebody just threw a Molotov cocktail through the front window of a regular grocery store or convenience store. Somebody just chucked a Molotov cocktail right into it. Because along with the information, the documents that got dumped, were the body cams of the ARU, where merfolk were being gunned down, beaten, and all sorts of crimes, like just recorded all from first person perspective, being played in clips and loops on screens all over Stella Maurice. And there is a great rise in the level of tension in the city. It is palpable. And that is where we are going to end the session. Yeah, probably. Oh, the very, very last thing that we see of this scene. Is Mikey here? He might still be gone.
Where did Mikey go?
Oh, he probably had to go do something with his
baby. So
the last thing that we see of Mikey and Rust is Rust being very confused and scared, and then somebody breaking the window, the passenger side window of the car, and dragging him out of it.
No!
Damn, really?
And that's where it ends. And there you go.
Rust, please.
Rust is in danger.
We must save Rust.
Yeah. Ignore everything else.
Skip trial, hunt down Rust.
Yeah, pretty much.
Aw. We need him.
I do love our squid baby, so yes.
So, I'll say over between this session and the next session, you can expect that the streets will be very violent as roving mobs have begun to take their social protests to the streets. Not all violent, but quite a bit of it is getting pretty violent out there.
Great.
Oh, yeah.
Thanks for interfering, Ice Peak. Was really, really, really thinking about it.
Well, then we would just been in a Satan duel.
It's like such a rare chance, you know?
Now, Ice Peak saved your ass because Alsatia was right there.
It's true. I forgot all about her.
She would have turned you into whale meat?
Yeah, pretty much.
Well, you guys haven't seen it, but that's the sheet woman is not her actual form.
That's her stand?
No, the stand is the napkin that she's wearing.
Oh, the napkin! Okay, I like it.
Yeah, you guys, I think people will probably like the full picture of the awakening whenever it's finished.
I'm probably just gonna upload this raw so people can just watch it and review it if they want.